for us. She's spokesperson for One Law for All, which is an anti-Sharia campaign group. She's spokesperson for the Council of Ex-Muslims, and she's part of the organization called Equal Rights Now, which is an organization against women's discrimination in Iran, which is the country where she was born. She also hosts a program called Bread and Roses, which is transmitted via illegal satellites to Iran, and the government has called it immoral and corrupt, and I think she's quite proud of that. She's done a notable work with refugees, and she's been awarded the Secularist of the Year award in 2005. Well, some of you might have heard that on the 20th of October, she was invited to speak at Warwick University, but the student union there declined her. They said, and this is a quote, that she would be highly inflammatory and could incite violence. As a justification for that, they pointed towards their SU constitution, which says, on the speaker policy, they must seek to avoid to insulting faiths or groups within the framework of positive debate or challenge. Whilst I understand groups, but faiths are ideas. I think there's not been a time where free speech has been as relevant as today, where in the legislation of universities, which are supposed to be like the fortresses of freedom of thought and speech, there's ingrained the idea that certain thoughts are protected. I hope you're going to have an insight and an interesting time with Maryam Namazie, so please give her a round of applause.
Hello, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. And thank you to the agnostic, secularist, and humanist, however you say it, society for inviting me. Is there an echo here? It's really annoying me. No? I'm fine? Okay. Well, as you heard, I was recently barred from speaking at Warwick University. Also, Trinity College Dublin, the student group there, cancelled my talk after I refused restrictions on my talk. Of course, I spoke at both universities this month, so that was a very good step forward. But it was because they said that I was highly inflammatory, so watch out, and also that I could incite hatred on campus. And of course, these are very serious allegations based, I think, on the mistaken conflation of criticism of Islam, which is, of course, a belief, it's an idea, Islamism, which is a far-right-wing religious political movement, with bigotry against Muslims, who are people like anybody else. This conflation has led to a disturbing trend towards censorship on university campuses of much needed criticism of Islam and Islamism. Welcome. The days when unconditional free expression was championed by universities as a cornerstone of all rights are long gone. It's no longer unconditional free expression that seemed to be intrinsically good and progressive, but actually a defense of censorship and self-censorship. And of course, as the brilliant writer Kenan Malik says, no one puts it that way. No one says that they're pro-censorship, not even the most heinous regimes. I believe in free speech, but may well be the motto of our times, he says. And we've heard it all. I believe in free speech, but not if it's undermining security, not if it's gratuitously offensive, provocative, inflammatory, Islamophobic, discriminatory, or if it has the potential to insult and hurt religious sensibilities or incite hatred. All of the things which I've actually been accused of. In particular, criticism of Islam and Islamism, which I said is a far-right wing political movement, it seemed to be so harmful that it's often equated with bigotry against Muslims. Though, of course, this is not the case, just as criticism of Christianity or the vile Britain First is not bigotry against Christians. Postmodernists, such as The Guardian's David Shariat-Mallory and the Labour Party's Seamus Milne, they consider criticism of Islam antisocial and even dangerous. Something, by the way, that their Ayatollah friends in Iran also say, as do the regimes from Saudi Arabia to Pakistan. In my opinion, though, criticism of Islam is deemed dangerous, not because of some patronizing concern for minorities, but because in the age of ISIS, it subverts and challenges the sacred, which has always been a tool for the control of society in the interests of the dominant class under the guise of defending public sensibilities and morality. Criticism of Islam challenges religion in political power and opens the space for dissent where none is permissible or acceptable. Ironically, critics of religion like myself have never been free to express themselves, yet we are the ones who are deemed to be harmful and inciting hatred, when in fact it's the other way around. It's the blasphemers and apostates who have faced persecution throughout the ages. Clerics and the religious right wing have always been free to promote religion, any religion. And religion has always had a privileged position in societies, and even more so, where it has influence or state power or access, Britain included. Clearly, freedom of expression without the right to criticize religion is meaningless. Such criticism has been key for social progress, and historically it's been linked with anti-clericalism. And I think it's very much the same today. This is, by the way, a cartoon by a hijabi Egyptian woman cartoonist, because a lot of people see this and think that it's racist, but it's her way of opposing the Muslim Brotherhood and Islamism in Egypt, where she lives. Criticism of Islam and the state are analogous in many places, like Saudi Arabia, the Islamic State, Iran, where anything from demanding women's equality or trade union rights to condemning sexual jihad and the Islamic Cultural Revolution, I put that in quotes, which banned books and purified higher education in a place like Iran, can be met with arrest, imprisonment, and even the death penalty. Of course, there is a distinction between Islam as a belief versus Islamism, which is a far-right political movement. But Islam is not just a personal belief. It plays a political role in the form of laws and policies and as states and extreme right-wing political movements. When the religious right are in power, religion is at the center of the struggle for change, according to Iranian Marxist Hami Tahoui. If you want to defend equality between women and men, or put an end to male guardianship rules, which are the rules where women cannot travel without the permission of a male guardian, you will inevitably come face to face. Did my thing go off? You will inevitably come face to face with religion. If you want gay rights, if you want the right to organize First May Day rallies, or you want the right to strike, you will eventually confront religion.
It's off.
It's off, isn't it? Yeah. I think the battery finished.
I'm going to stop.
Well done. Yes. Okay. Do we need it?
We speak up a bit. Okay. Speak up a bit.
I will be very calm when keep I speak, so I do need a microphone. I have a tendency to speak too loud. So any jokes? Good jokes? This is Nottingham University, seriously. We have to bring our own batteries as well.
What does the slide show?
I'm sorry?
What does the slide illustrate?
It's a scene of an execution in Iran where they use cranes to hang people in public. Okay. Oh, there's a mattress here. Hello. No, it's okay. We'll just. Okay, so don't blame me if I talk too loud. Okay. So if you want to confront any of these rules and regulations, you do end up coming face to face with religion. Religion is not just a personal matter between a believer and his or her God, but regulations imposed on society with real and brutal punishments and repercussions for anyone who is deemed a transgressor, including, of course, many Muslims. The veil, for example, is far from a personal choice and right. Socially speaking, on a mass scale, it is enforced through compulsory veiling laws, acid attacks, imprisonment, fines, as well as pressures which look upon unveiled women as whores, immoral, and sources of fitna or chaos in society. Calling an improperly veiled woman in Britain, for example, hijabi, is one of those forms of pressure that women face. Under such circumstances, criticism of religion is key for the defense of rights and equality. It's also a critical necessity in order to dismantle and undermine the sacred and its political role. And it's not just about religion's role over there. Islamism is a vast global network with global reach. The Islamic regime of Iran, for example, will sentence a cartoonist, this artist, Atena Farahdani, to 12 years in prison for a cartoon, and also for illegitimate sexual relations because she shook hands with her lawyer. And the charge is illegitimate sexual relations short of adultery. That's what handshakes are in a theocracy. And for, of course, violating gender segregation rules. While here in Britain, you've got Universities UK endorsing gender segregation, which, of course, they've now withdrawn as a result of protests. And a student organizer, for example, advising me at one of the talks, one of the debates I had, not to shake hands prior to debate on Sharia law out of respect for some Islamists. Of course, I made it a point to shake hands, as I have no respect for an idea that sees me as haram, so that a man cannot shake my hands. Call me what you will. Islamism as a political movement is a global killing machine that affects people everywhere. They will hack atheist bloggers to death in Bangladesh, whilst placing UK-based Bangladeshi bloggers on death lists. And lovely British jihadis will kill for ISIS, like Muhammad Emwazi, whilst a UK-based organization, Cage Prisoners, promotes defensive jihad. Limiting free expression to that which is acceptable for the Islamists, as it is those in power, after all, that determine the limits of expression, restricts the right to speak for those who need it most. It's telling people like myself that we cannot oppose the theocracies we fled from, or that people living under the boot of the religious right, or faced with segregation and Sharia laws right here in Britain, must not refuse and resist. It's our culture and religion after all. We have no choice but to submit. Ironically, the postmodernist leftists, and I'm someone on the left myself, who push this line have one set of progressive politics for themselves. They rightly want gay marriage, women's equality, and the right to criticize archbishops and the Pope, as well as Jesus Christ, and the Christian right, including Britain First or the EDL, but they have another set of rules for us. We are merely allowed to make demands within the confines of Islam and identity politics, and only after taking note of the power imbalance. As an ex-Muslim migrant woman, I am supposedly a minority within a minority, but somehow this power imbalance never seems to be part of any calculation. If we speak, we are labeled native informants by so-called progressives. And the far right accuses us of practicing taqiyya. If we oppose their scapegoating of Muslims and immigrants and placing collective blame on the other. I have often been accused of practicing taqiyya. I'm actually an undercover Muslim. by the likes of Robert Spencer and Pamela Geller. And taqiyya is basically whereby we Muslims are allowed to lie to advance the cause of Islam, gaining the trust of all of you naive non-believers in order to draw out your vulnerability and defeat you. What those conflating Islam, Islamism, and Muslims miss, both on the left as well as the far right, is that many Muslims are also critics of Islamism and even Islam. In fact, Muslims are those presumed to be Muslims, people like myself. We're often the first victims of Islamism and at the forefront of resistance. Clearly, not everyone in the Islamic world or so-called Muslim community, or even those who are labeled Muslim students on campus, are Muslims. And even if they are, religion is not necessarily the only characteristic that defines them. Moreover, the rise of Islamism has brought with it a corresponding rise in the demand for atheism, secularism, and particularly women's liberation. Now, this is a protest in Afghanistan just this past week against the heinous stoning of Rukhsana. You've heard about her, the 19-year-old girl who was stoned by the Taliban for eloping with a man she loved and fleeing a forced marriage. The banner here, this is a protest in Kabul just this week. It says, the filthy hands of the merchants of religion should be cut short from our country so that every day we are not witness to the suffering of the many Rukhsanes and also Farhondes. Farhonde is another young woman who was killed, and I'll talk about her case a bit later. Ordinary Muslims, like all other believers, pick and choose and mold their beliefs to make them compatible with contemporary life, which is why they often don't recognize their religion in the Islamists. Conflating criticism of Islam and Islamism with bigotry against Muslims sees dissent through the eyes of the Islamists and not those who refuse and resist. For those who have brought into this Islamist narrative, there are no social and political movements, no class politics, dissenters, women's rights campaigners, socialists, just homogenized Muslims, and you should actually read Islamists when you talk about homogenized Muslims, who face intimidation and discrimination if an ex-Muslim woman speaks on a university campus. And this is the problem with multiculturalism and identity politics. I mean, this is the exact idea that people have of the authentic Muslim. You know, the homogenized group identity is the only one that seems to exist. And I'll tell you something about this cartoon. This was a cartoon that Musa Bouderi, he's a professor at the oldest Palestinian university, he had put this cartoon on his door, and he received many death threats from Islamists at the university on the cartoon. And he, you know, he did say that what gives the Islamists the right to decide for me as a Muslim what cartoon I want to post on my door and what I can and I can't think, basically. And this is the problem with multiculturalism as a social policy, not as a wonderful lived experience, and identity politics, because this sort of homogenized group identity is the only one that seems to exist. The authentic Muslim is always vague, always reactionary, always pro-Sharia courts, always pro-gender segregation, always wants the death penalty for apostates and gay people, anti-Semitic, and of course always anti-free expression. That's the impression of the authentic Muslim. And this is an example of movement in Iran against the veil. The veil is compulsory in Iran. If you're improperly veiled, or of course unveiled, it's met with punishment, fines, imprisonment, and also, of course, there's been acid attacks on women who are deemed to be improperly veiled. But there's a movement now of women unveiling in Iran and posting them on social media. And this woman has posted her unveiled photo in front of a poster which says, "Sisters, you should respect Islamic hijab." So I think that's actually a wonderful photograph, isn't it? Now, the thing that Algerian sociologist Maryam Namazie says is that what is most upsetting in all this is this implication
that oppressed people can only turn out as fascists, never revolutionaries. Is this really what the left of Europe thinks? And she adds, can the left really accept that citizens are assigned minority identity, often against their will, on the basis of their name or their geographical origin or that of their families? Can the left accept that this communal identity supersedes their civil rights? This is what was done to the Jews under Nazism. Will the left accept that this be done to Muslims or those presumed to be Muslims, regardless of their personal beliefs? If the left is serious about supporting oppressed minorities, it should realize that those who speak in the name of the community do not necessarily have the legitimacy to do so. And by siding with the fundamentalists, they simply choose one camp in a political struggle without acknowledging it. The result of all this, says Kinan Malek, is that solidarity has become increasingly defined not in political terms, as collective action in pursuit of certain political ideals and goals, but in terms of ethnicity and culture. And since those in power determine the dominant culture, many student unions, many people on the left, feminists also, will side with the Islamists at our expense. They don't see that at its core, this is a photo of the largest mass protest in Egypt against the Muslim Brotherhood in contemporary history. They don't see that at its core, this is a fight between theocrats and the religious right on the one hand, and secularists and those fighting for social justice on the other, including many people who are believers. It's a fight taking place within and across boundaries and communities, including especially amongst those who are labeled Muslim community or world. Now, I wanted you to take this example of Farhunde. I mentioned her a bit earlier. She's a 27-year-old woman who was accused by a mullah of being an infidel. He accused her of burning the Quran. And as a result, she was attacked by a mob, and she was lynched, she was stoned, she was run over, her body was burnt and thrown into the river, whilst onlookers and the police stood by. I don't know if you've all heard of her case. Have you heard of her case? Yeah? Good. So when this happened, one of these liberal do-gooders on Twitter, you know, had said, well, what can she expect if she violates Muslim sensibilities in this manner? And, you know, it's the sort of liberal do-gooders that always do good for religion and the religious right, but never for women and human beings. And what's interesting about this case is that actually Farhunde was Muslim as well. And she was actually a very devout Muslim. The reason she had an argument with the mullah was because she was telling him to stop selling amulets to women, stop selling them superstition. And what happened after her case, just as one example, is that it shows very clearly that all Muslims do not think the same. Not all Afghans think the same as well. And they don't all have the same homogenized sensibilities. Women carried her coffin, her body, going against Islamic customs. They took her, they carried her coffin to the gravesite with her family's permission. And they were encircled by men who were there to protect them. And these women surrounded the coffin right until the end, gave her the respect she deserved, and chanted, "We are all Farhunde." And when a mullah, who had initially justified her killing, when he saw that there were so many protests in support of her, he changed his mind, as the religious clerics often do, and tried to come to her gravesite and burial. And they actually encircled her coffin, and they refused to allow him to attend the funeral, and they forced him to leave. They basically kicked him out. And Azar Yun, who's a youth activist in Afghanistan, she says, this is what Farhunde teaches me, that together we can change the narrative that others write about women. We stood up against the most respected mullah, we carried the coffin, and we buried her. And there's another medical student, Niyaya, she says that if it was the first time where I realized my real power and told myself that I am breaking the boundaries of tradition. So clearly, the people of Afghanistan do not all agree, Muslims are not all the same, and Muslims, I put in quotes, because not everyone living in Iran or Afghanistan or Saudi Arabia are Muslims, or Islamists, just like not everyone in Britain is Christian or the EDL. Britain first. Everywhere, from Iran to Afghanistan and Algeria, there are women and men who break taboos and change narratives and stand against religion's encroachment in people's lives and against Islamism. And this is a photo from this week against the stoning of Roshana. And of course, there is also an image of Farhan there in one of the placards. And I think this is such a powerful image, isn't it? And one you don't see of the Muslim world. But luckily, that's changing. And Charlie Hebdo is another very good example, because that is an issue, you know, an issue of contention. You've got 145 writers who disgracefully opposed Penn's award to Charlie, but Penn went ahead and gave them the award, rightly so, because they said that Charlie was valorizing selectively offensive material that intensifies the anti-Islamic, anti-Maghreb, anti-Arab sentiments already prevalent in the Western world. But as Salman Rushdie said, the Charlie Hebdo artists were executed in cold blood for drawing satirical cartoons, which is an entirely legitimate activity. It is quite right that Penn should honor their sacrifice and condemn their murder. This issue has nothing to do, he says, with oppressed and disadvantaged minorities. It has everything to do with a battle against fanatical Islam, which is highly organized, well-funded, and which seeks to terrify us all, Muslims as well as non-Muslims, into cowed silence. And a lot of people, including Muslims, agree with Salman Rushdie. Mostafa Urad, he's a native Algerian and copy editor for Charlie, who was killed in the attack. You have a French Muslim cafe owner who was threatened for putting up a Je suis Charlie sign in his East London cafe. In Turkey, two columnists have been facing an investigation for religious defamation after featuring the Charlie cover. And cartoonists across the Arab world, from Egypt to Lebanon to Qatar and Jordan, took a stand with Charlie and against the Islamists. Even in Iran, which is a theocracy where 130 offenses are punishable by death, Nasrin Sotoudeh, who's already been imprisoned before, she's a human rights lawyer, she showed her solidarity with the Charlie, with her Charlie colleagues, whilst journalists who were trying to rally in support of Charlie in Iran were attacked and prevented from protesting by Iranian regime security agents wielding clubs and chains. An Iranian newspaper was shut down for publishing a photo showing solidarity with Charlie. So clearly, not all Muslims were offended, and even those who were did not go on to kill for it. There are many such examples. In Bangladesh, there are Islamists threatening and killing beloved atheist and secularist bloggers and free thinkers like Abhijit Roy, but there is also a deeply secular movement against them, including 24 villages which have become known as Jamaat Free Villages. That's the main Islamist group in Bangladesh, or terrorist free villages. Religion is not the only marker that defines our societies, nor is it one of the most important in many instances. I, for example, only read the Quran after I became an ex-Muslim atheist. I was born into it, just as nearly everyone is, depending on where they are born. It's geography and your parents' religion that mostly determines yours. In Iran, I didn't have to wear a veil. I went to a mixed school. I wasn't treated differently because I was a girl. I hadn't heard the terms taqiyya or jihad. Religion only became really relevant in my life when it came to power in Iran. Then the veil became an issue. Then Hezbollah types were sent to my school to separate the boys from the girls, though of course we ran circles around them. And that lack of choice and labeling follows them even into adulthood until the day they die, unless they make what is often a very difficult and painful choice to leave. People's religion is not necessarily, and more likely not, the religion of the Islamists. Islamists would not need to kill so many if everyone agreed with them. Islamism's culture is not our culture, or the culture of the many who refuse and resist. Nonetheless, this conflation of Islam, Islamism, and Muslims has been the position of successive British governments, whereby multiculturalism and multifaithism have been promoted as social policies to defend religion's role in the public space, impose religious identity as the only marker to define citizens, and hand over large segments of citizens to be managed and controlled by regressive Islamists, Islamic organizations, and parasitical imams. This has been part of the neocon project for the extreme right-wing restructuring of societies. There are no more citizens, but segregated communities with their own faith schools, their own faith-based services, and even their own faith-based courts, separate and unequal. The far right too, which claims to despise multiculturalism, benefits from the idea of difference to scapegoat the other and promote its own form of vile white identity politics. Ironically, left groups, which are traditionally anti-state, reiterate the government's multiculturalism, multi-faithism, and identity politics, as well as the far-right narrative, and side with our oppressors by placing individuals into homogenized, restrictive boxes, denying dissent and diversity, and equating Muslims with Islamists, of course, in different ways. Rather than siding with the vast secular and progressive forces in the so-called Muslim communities and the so-called Islamic world, this section of the left, which Richard Dawkins calls the regressive left, sides with and pushes the Islamist narrative and denies universalism, sees rights, equality, and secularism as Western, justifies the suppression of women, apostates, blasphemers under the guise of respect for other cultures, imputing on innumerable people the most reactionary elements of culture and religion, which is that of the religious right wing. In this world of apologists, the oppressor is victim, the oppressed incite hatred, and any criticism is seen to be bigotry. Of course, where Islamists are in power, there are no such niceties about concern for minorities and safe spaces. Dissenters are prosecuted under blasphemy laws, apostasy laws, enmity against God, full stop. People like Raif Badawi, sentenced to 10 years in prison and 1,000 lashes in Saudi Arabia for raising the question of religion and politics. Shahrokh Zamani, found dead recently in prison in Iran, after being sentenced to 11 years in prison for labor organizing in a country where the strike has been deemed to be haram or religiously forbidden. Someone like women's rights campaigner Saad al-Shamari, who has been imprisoned on accusations of insulting Islam and the Prophet in Saudi Arabia for demanding an end to male guardianship rules for women. Poet Fatima Naout, on trial in Egypt for insulting Islam because she has criticized Islamic animal slaughter. And 47-year-old Roya Nobakhsh, she's British-Iranian, she actually went to visit her family from Britain. She's been sentenced initially to 20 years in prison for insulting Islam because on her Facebook page, she said that the Iranian regime is a little too Islamic. Saying Charlie Hebdo cartoonist had it coming is like saying that Shahrokh Zamani deserved to die in prison and that Raif Badawi deserves his lashes for being inflammatory and offending Islam and the Islamists in power. Here, of course, rather than accusations of blasphemy or apostasy, critics face charges of Islamophobia and offense. What's packaged as the culture of offense is really Islamism's imposition of blasphemy laws under the pretext of respect for Muslim sensibilities. As I've said before, this is very much the government and political establishment's line as well. In September, police removed artwork by Mimsy from London's mall galleries, which showed mimesis lurking in the background featuring children's toys, Sylvanian families, after the police raised serious concerns on the potentially inflammatory content. Now I'm going to show you some more of these photos, so look away if you cannot tolerate this inflammatory content. Basically, they're saying you can't criticize ISIS. That's what the British government and police are saying. Ah, you survived. Well done. The culture of offense absurdly implies that civility and manners are all that are needed to stop abductions and the slaughter of generations from Nigeria, Iran to Algeria. But the culture of offense is a smokescreen. It serves to legitimize Islamist terror and blame the victims. It misses the point. Being a woman, being a free thinker, being gay, being unveiled, being improperly veiled, being an atheist, going to school, driving a car, having sex that is not religiously prescribed, falling in love, laughing out too loud, dancing, all of these offend them. Calling for civility, censorship, silence, or respect for the offended is merely heeding the Islamist demand for submission at the expense of dissenters. But as Rosa Luxemburg said, freedom is always the freedom of dissenters. Charges of offense and Islamophobia aim not to prevent bigotry. You can't stop bigotry by censorship, but to stop criticism and deflect legitimate outrage against Islamism. It really aims to prevent blasphemy. This is a fantastic Jesus and Mo cartoon. Jesus says, if we want to live together peacefully in a multicultural society, we must ensure that everyone's fundamental beliefs are protected from attack and ridicule. And the barmaid says, I don't want my fundamental beliefs to be protected, thanks. Please feel free to attack and ridicule them anytime you wish. There's a pause. And Muhammad says, racist. Calling it racism fails to understand that the other also has its dissenters who want to live free from religion's stranglehold. Plus, isn't it racist to imply that all Muslims cannot tolerate criticism and free thought other than via violence, or that Muslims are one and the same as Islamists? Islamophobia is a political term coined by Islamists and their apologists to scaremonger people into silence and to censor dissent. Now, I want to give you one example of this. There is a group called MEND, and one of their staff people was saying, Allahu Akbar, this is great news, the government is now going to make it legal for police forces to record Islamophobic attacks as a separate hate crime like anti-Semitism. And obviously it's very good if we have, the more records we have on any type of violence against people, it's a good thing. So following on from that though, I want to draw your attention to this conflation and what the whole accusation of Islamophobia is really leading to. And then he goes, for anyone who's doubting how important this news is, all you need to do is spend 5 minutes at MEND, which is his organization, and see the challenges that we have to overcome to get to this stage, alhamdulillah. Then he says, and that's the part that's in red, this is the first major step in completely outlawing Islamophobia in the UK. Make dua that just like anti-Semitism, anyone who writes or says anything malicious against Islam will be prosecuted in the future, inshallah. So again, I want to just say that, you know, anti-Muslim bigotry, which has to be stopped and condemned, and, you know, we need to work against any sort of attack on people, is very different from stopping criticism from religion, of religion, and basically stopping blasphemy. The solution, in my opinion, lies in returning back to basics, which is citizenship rights, equality of people irrespective of beliefs, respect are for people, not for religions, and certainly not for the religious right wing. An end to faith-based initiatives that divide and segregate, universal rights, one law for all with equal access to justice, an uncompromising defense of secularism and the separation of religion from the state, and of course, unconditional free expression. As philosopher Roger Scruton said earlier this month, if you invoke the law at all, it should be to protect the one who gives the offense and not the one who takes it. But of course, now it seems it is the other way around. To combat the normalization and legitimization of censorship, free thinkers must celebrate blasphemy, according to Femen's Ina Shevchenko. As I think we must celebrate apostasy. We're not allowed to leave Islam. We can be executed for leaving Islam. Then it becomes all the more urgent to renounce Islam publicly via groups like the Council of Ex-Muslims. When it is possible to shout our atheism from every rooftop, then the very need to do so will not have the same urgency. Blasphemy and apostasy, of course, are not a denial of religious freedom. There is no freedom of religion without freedom from religion. And criticism of religion, in my opinion, is an essential aspect of being fully human in the age of ISIS. Freedom to express liberation from religion is also very much relevant when it comes to nude protest. The idealized woman in Islam is obedient, properly veiled, submissive, and accepting of her assigned place in society. And this is a billboard in Iran where it says the hijab is your protection. And it's, I'm sure you've seen many different types of versions of this, but this is, you know, if you're not veiled, you are like uncovered sweets where the flies and everything will get at you. So watch out, there's no flies here, thankfully. But, the rest of us, according to this sort of way of thinking, is we're often compared to unwrapped sweets, covered in flies, free for the taking. We're the source of fitna or chaos in society and blamed for every calamity and natural disaster. You've heard earthquakes are our fault as well. As well as, of course, the disintegration of the family, society, deserving of punishment in order to maintain national and Islamic values, pride and honor. Islamism's obsession with women's bodies and its insistence that the woman be veiled and hidden from view means that nudity becomes an important form of public resistance. Islamists want us bound in body bags, not seen and not heard. We refuse to comply. Just as we refuse to stop blaspheming and apostatizing or demanding secularism and free expression. This is a photo of myself, Alia Madarmati from Egypt, and Amina Taylor from Tunisia. It was for 8th March protest in front of the Louvre. And basically, I've cut out the Allah from the Iranian regime's flag and put something much more worthy in its place. Those who consider apostasy or blasphemy as culturally inappropriate, Western, colonialists are only considering Islamism's sensibilities and values, not that of the many who refuse and resist. Only when we begin to see that dissent, acknowledge that it is intrinsically linked with our own, and defend universal values, secularism, free expression, and a renewed enlightenment against the Islamic Inquisition, will we be able to truly honor our dissenters, stand with them, and push back the religious right wing. Clearly, in all this, free expression is key. It's not a luxury, it's not a privilege, but a right. It's not up for sale. For many of us, it is the only way we can fight to breathe, to challenge those in power who stifle us, and to demand change. Limiting free expression is not just censorship, as Salman Rushdie says, but it is an assault on human nature. Human beings, he says, shape their future by arguing and challenging and saying the unsayable, not by bowing their knees, whether to gods or to men. In the age of ISIS, this is a historical task and necessity. Thank you. over to questions and answers, I do want to make a plea on behalf of migrants, because there is so much anti-migrant and, of course, so much wonderful pro-refugee welcome, migrants welcome sentiments as well, but a really virulent racism and bigotry and xenophobia against people who are fleeing. And personally, I think migrants are the best of all of our societies, because there are people who refuse to accept intolerable conditions, who are voting with their very feet, and who dare to dream that another life is actually possible, despite the horrors and terrors and the dangers of both leaving their homes and also the process of flight. So I think if we are opposed to US-led imperialism, the war here and there that oftentimes governments perpetrate in our name, if we're opposed to dictatorships, if we're opposed to ISIS and the Islamists and theocracies, then we have no choice. We have a moral duty to defend and stand with migrants. So I do want to make that plea, because I think it is hugely important in this discussion that we don't forget that there are real live victims and survivors of these very issues that we're talking about who are trying to reach safety, and they deserve asylum, whether you like it or not. People have a right to asylum, and I think we need to unequivocally defend that, and from my perspective, we should defend open borders. So. Should I just take my...
Yeah, I just want to say, we don't have a separate microphone, so people can just speak up and you can just take... just put your hands up. Thank you.
Great. Please, of course, feel free to give comments, and you don't just have to ask me questions. Obviously, I'm sure there are some disagreements, and that's fine. I think we can all manage it. And also, I thought maybe I'll take a few comments and questions before I respond, just so that I'm not the only one talking the whole time. At least none of you have fallen asleep, which is good. Or it's too dark, maybe. So if there's anyone who has questions, comments about anything, I'd be really happy to hear what you have to say and respond. So let me just move this picture, sorry. Yeah. Yes?
Well, you've given us a long catalogue of the crimes of Islamicism, and they are truly appalling, it is true. But you didn't actually say anything about what has brought all this about, which I think is fairly important, because the rise of Muslim fundamentalism, it hasn't come out of nowhere, it hasn't dropped out of the sky, and I would suggest to you that it's got a lot to do with imperialism. Mm-hmm. What your perspective on that is. Also, a lot of, here we are under the auspices of ASH, a lot of us here, not everybody, will be secularists of one sort or another. And we have to face up to the fact, and this is a point of self-criticism for people like me, that secular doctrines in Islamic countries have failed. May I say, not least in your own country, because if we go back, say, to the 1950s, 60s, 70s in Iran, the leftists were strong, stronger than the Islamicists, and yet the Islamicists triumphed. Mm-hmm. They vanquished the secular leftists. So two points there, really, I'd like you to respond
Great.
To.
Thank you. Thank you. Do I see a hand somewhere? Yes?
Hi. As a witness to the growing population, Muslim populations in European countries, especially in light of the refugee crisis, do you believe there's an impetus on the governments to provide a form of cultural accommodation?
Okay. Sorry, did you have a question?
UNASH has had quite a number of dealings with some progressive, more progressive and secularist Muslim groups, so like the Party and the British Muslim Secular Democracy. How much of do you think that their cause is going to take off and represent some of the people that a non-religious secular group might not be able to?
Oh, then a secular group can't. They are a secular group.
A non-religious secular group.
I see.
So
okay.
They're being a religious secular group. Do they have a commercial utility in that area?
Okay. Shall I try and answer those and then maybe get some more questions? Yeah. I'll start with this question here. I mean, we work with lots of progressive Muslim groups, including British Muslims for Secular Democracy. On the 10th of December, we're actually handing in a statement calling for the dismantling of parallel legal systems in this country, from the Sharia courts as well as the Beth Din, which are the Jewish courts. And we're going to have a delegation going to 10 Downing Street to hand the letters in on International Human Rights Day. And of course, those of us who are handing it in includes a representative of British Muslims for Secular Democracy, as well as people like Pragna Patel from Southall Black Sisters and Geeta Sakhal from Center for Secular Space, from the Iranian Kurdish Women's Rights Organization that's done a lot of work on forced marriages and honor killings and so on and so forth. So, I think it's important to work together on as many issues as possible. I do think that we can have religious believers who are seculars and non-religious believers who are secularists as well. And I think our aims are the same, so I don't think it really matters if you're a Muslim group or not. Of course, the more space that's opened up, the more people will be able to speak outside of the imposed identity politics, which is often, the sort of the identity I spoke about, this homogenized, Muslim identity that's always sort of reactionary. They always want the Muslim Council of Britain or Anjum Chowdhury to speak on behalf of Muslims. And luckily now we are seeing that there are more groups coming up and speaking, and I think that that is always a positive thing. And I think it's something that will help push more of the space open. And even though we're an atheist group, we're an ex-Muslim group, I think we have helped in push open the space, because when you do push open the space for dissent and for alternative views, you don't just do it for yourself, you do it for everybody that has a dissenting view and who thinks differently. On the Muslim population, I don't quite understand that question. I mean, the thing is, there is no Muslim population. This is my argument. There is no Muslim population. There are people who are Muslims, but people coming from Syria may also be atheists. They may also be Christians. They may also be Yazidis. They may also be, various other, agnostics. And so I think our first step is to see people and not sort of homogenize communities or identities. I mean, in a place like Iran, there's a huge anti-Islamic backlash, in my opinion. It's a huge, atheist. I think there is a tsunami of atheism taking place in our region, and one that we haven't even begun to see the tip of the iceberg of. So there is no such thing as, I think, the Muslim community in that sense. And I think it's important to see people as people, deserving the right to asylum, deserving the right to protection. Again, I don't think any sort of accommodation of beliefs, why not start treating people like citizens, irrespective of their beliefs? And I think that's what we need to go back to, is not look at people as religious identities or ethnic identities, but as human beings and as citizens. And I think we'll be able to go a lot further that way. So. On the issue of, where this all started, and I mean, you make some very good points. For us, at least with the Iranian experience, I mean, Islamism is something that came about when this movement took over the Iranian revolution, which was not an Islamic revolution, it was a left-leaning revolution. But we have to remember that it was during a period of the Cold War when US foreign policy was very much in tune with accommodating and supporting and funding Islamic groups as a way of creating what they used to call a green belt around the Soviet Union at the time, an Islamic belt. And so a lot of these groups that are now massacring people in those countries, from the Taliban, the Mujahideen, you name it, they have initially been very often funded and supported by US imperialism and militarism. Of course, though, I think that's not the whole story, though, because the reality is that these groups now are forces that stand on their own 2 feet. And you can't always blame the West for everything. You know, they stand on their own 2 feet. They are a form of imperialism in many of the countries that they are ruling in. And so I think we need to look at this movement as a movement on its own 2 feet. But of course, it's important to see where it began. In Iran, too, as I mentioned, the revolution was a left-leaning revolution. But there was a meeting of the great powers in Guadeloupe, I'm not sure if you've heard about this, but where they decided that they prefer an Islamic state to a left-leaning sort of state, which would be unclear. And so they promoted Khomeini and brought him from obscurity to center stage. So I do think there is a link with all this. I wouldn't say the leftists in Iran were secularists. I'm not sure. Iran itself was not a secular society. Before the Islamists took power, there was a lot of reliance and use of religion. But I do think that secularism is a very natural and homegrown demand for anyone who lives in a theocracy. I think, you know, if you live in a theocracy where you can be charged with 12 years in prison for shaking hands with your lawyer, if you can, you know, you're prevented from going to see a football match because you're a woman and you're not allowed to go into a football match. If you can't walk with your boyfriend on the street because it would be considered illegal to do so. In such a situation and in countries like Iran where 70% of the population are young, you can see that there is going to be this fight back and this tension, and it's very real. And so I think this need for secularism, I would say maybe people might not call it secularism, but I think deep down a lot of people understand the need to separate religion from politics, particularly if they actually care about their religion. A lot of people like my father, who's Muslim, will want the separation of religion from the state only in order to protect Islam's, you know, its name being dragged in the mud by the Islamists. You know, so I think in that sense it is a real grassroots sort of demand bubbling from below. Yes.
I wanted to ask you about where you think the struggle for freedom and the ability to speak against Islam is now. Because it seems to me that despite the horrors we've seen, partly because the horrors we've seen in the Middle East by ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Nusra and so on, there has been a certain awakening. And also focusing on where the problem is. But people ask where the problem is, where Islam is, but it's where Sunni Islamism comes from. And it's quite clear to me that it comes from Saudi Arabia, significantly, who actually are very busy throughout the so-called Muslim world, educating people for a huge amounts of money, trying to create a force that will be allied to them. And I think now we're focusing, we need to focus on that, because that is what's behind the ideology. And I wonder whether you thought that things were freeing up a bit now, the last year, whether you were more confident we're going to come through this.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I'm sorry, Maryam, but I'm going to have to pull you out on dodging that question, because of course to see people as anything else outside their religion is important, but it's rather disingenuous claim to people to make people do not identify as Muslims. What I'm asking is, should these communities that do identify as Muslim and do want some accommodation, should they be accommodated by the government?
Well, that might be a better question. It's clearer now, yeah.
Well, I've heard about things from a left perspective, but I'm from the right, and I'm quite a libertarian. And I don't think it's the role of the government to get involved in religion. I think, of course, there's nothing but a problem. I also like special relations and things like that. I'm very, very scathing of the socialists and the liberals and people for allowing this nonsense. I've got a lot of blame on Tony Blair because he had his religious agenda, and I think that his thing about taking offence is leading to a blasphemy law, through the back door, and a member of a church in Northern Ireland is being prosecuted for saying, and I think that's all wrong. I'm also agreeing with the man back there, about Saudi Arabia. I think it's an evil country that uses its oil wealth to demonstrate hate around the world. And I think it's that...
To the, hypocritically, to the funeral or the commemoration to the Charlie Hebdo victims, at the same time, say, are executing people in Saudi Arabia at twice the rate that they've done previous years. It's intensifying the Saudi repression of free speech. We set up a campaign, but the purpose of this campaign is to question this UK government, because we're in the UK, government's relationship with Saudi Arabia. So, we're the third largest military supplier to Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia itself has the fourth largest military spending on the planet, despite being only 30, 35 million people. It's closely behind China and America. They've got a huge force. They're now bombing Yemen. They are active within Syria, trying to get win over al-Qaeda to Saudi Arabia to establish their hegemony over the international Wahhabist movement. So Saudi Arabia, to me, is the big issue that we should be dealing with. We have tremendous possibilities of bringing pressure. And what we're trying to do, we're organising a campaign, which meets first time next week, and I'm going to see Maryam again next week at that meeting, where we'll be discussing trying to end particularly the arms trade between Britain and Saudi Arabia, because we can see how those arms are being done. We've managed to stop a contract 2 months ago as a result of pressure we put on through the Labour Party and through that on the government on them providing resources for the prison service. Actually, they were about to sign a contract with the Saudi prisons to provide them with the logistical support and advice about how to do their lashings and how to do their executions, presumably. That's led to a lot of public outrage, and we're hoping to build that campaign across the country, a big campaign over the next year to end Britain's support for the Saudi Arabian regime. I'll hopefully be in contact with the UNASH here about that in future. Thanks.
And what's the website people can find?
It's called We Are Rafe.
We Are Rafe, yeah.
We Are Rafe, UK.org.
In case people want to get more involved in this campaign. I think where the struggle is now, I think it's obviously as a result of seeing the atrocities and people getting to, I think it's become a bit closer to home, at least for people here in the West, because for us, I think in the Middle East, North Africa, South Asia, it has been a reality for many decades. But since September 11th, 7/7, and now as a result of ISIS and having European jihadis actually going and fighting for ISIS, who are born and bred in Britain and Germany and elsewhere, I think it has woken a lot of people up. So in that sense, I think it's helped people see what sort of dangerous movement we're dealing with. But also I think because of social media and the internet, we're able to bypass a lot of the sort of mainstream media, which very often doesn't tell you the whole story. I don't want to sound like a conspiracy theorist, but you know how you always see, you know, the Chaudhary women in Iran going and shouting death to America, but you hardly get to see very often the other side of it. And I think that's changed a lot, actually, and I think it is as a result of social media. Even if you look at the number of atheists in the Middle East and North Africa, people are getting to hear about ex-Muslims and atheists in that country. Again, it's got to do with the fact that people are able now, with citizenship journalism, the fact that they can transmit ideas and protest movements. You know, we got a photo of that protest in Afghanistan a few minutes after it happened. And, you know, so in that sense, I think it is hopeful because you do get to see not just the brutality, which we always saw anyway, but only very often it was the brutality against Westerners and not brutality against, you know, people who are being killed day in and day out by this movement, and very often nobody even heard about some of them, but we're also seeing a lot of the resistance, so I do think it's quite a positive thing. I mean, I think Saudi Arabia is one of the centers of Islamism, and it's really important to fight it. I think the left is more comfortable also fighting Saudi Arabia because it's got good relations with the state, and if it's got good relations with the state, then the left is going to be all over it. And I think we need to be careful about that too, because there are, like, you have Stop the War Coalition, who's anti the Saudi regime, but they're pro-Assad, they're pro-the Iranian regime. You know, and so it's not to forget that this is not just a Wahhabi thing. There are Islamists in Iran, the Iranian so-called revolution, the Islamic revolution. The rise of Islamism in contemporary history has begun very much so since they took power in Iran. I mean, you're seeing country after country fall to Sharia law, becoming more Islamicized. Even Sharia courts in this country did not exist until the mid-80s. That's when they started. Again, it's very closely linked to this sort of exportation of Islamism. And of course, there are the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, there are the Jamaat-e-Islami, which have a lot of hold here in Britain, whose strongholds are in South Asia. So I think it's important to see all of that and to try to get, you know, the left that only seems to see Saudi Arabia to also stop siding with our oppressors and side with people against them as well. So I think that's something we're going to need to be working on. On the question of accommodation, I think a lot of my talk was on the fact that we shouldn't be accommodating. One, because not everyone thinks the same. Yeah, so the Christian community is not all the same, the Muslim community is not all the same, all English people are not all the same. Some people are members of EDL, some are members of UKIP. I'll try not to gag while I say that. And then there are others who are members of SWP, and there are lots of good people in between here. But so what I want to say is that if you start making policies based on what you think people's beliefs are, you're going to get it very wrong, because obviously the belief that is given, pushed to you, shoved down your throat as the dominant belief, is actually very often what those in power decide. You know, so if you look at the Muslim community, it's going to be what the Islamists say, what the Muslim Council of Britain says, what the Muslim Association of Britain says, which says that stoning in an ideal Islamic state is perfectly fine. A lot of Muslims would not agree with that, many in my family as well. So I think, especially in societies which are plural, and all of our societies are plural, there isn't a society anymore that isn't. You have to, in fact, keep beliefs out if you're going to treat people fairly, you know? And so I think you can't accommodate beliefs, because don't forget that there are dissenters in those communities, there are people who don't think the same way, and any time you sort of accommodate a belief system, it's going to be in favor of those who are using that to suppress free thinkers and dissenters in those communities. So I think, you know, that's why I think it's important to not label people as a certain religious or ethnic or whatever identity, and to start looking at people as human beings and also as citizens. Citizenship is a hugely important key in all of this, you know, people starting to feel like they are, you know, they are citizens in a country, rather than saying, you're the Muslim community, you can go to your Sharia courts, and of course we've cut all legal aid, so you actually have no more choice, but it's your choice, you know, because you can't afford legal aid, there's no legal aid anymore. So you go to your own courts, you go to your own schools, and then we'll complain about how you're so segregated from everybody else. You know, and it's the same thing happening across other countries as well, and I think it's just a prescription for disaster, you know. And so, yes, so my answer is definitely no accommodation. And the thing is, when we talk about, you know, this is what's happened where everything's gone topsy-turvy, is when we talk about people having rights, people having equality, freedoms, we always raised it vis-a-vis the individual, yeah? You have rights, you have freedoms. Now, when you accommodate beliefs, you give beliefs those rights. And what happens is whenever they have, when beliefs and the religious right have rights, people don't. And that's how it usually works. The more rights they have, the less anybody else has, everybody else has. So, yeah, I think it's definitely a bad idea. Any other questions?
As an Iranian myself, a lot of what was said, like, I've seen it firsthand. And I was just wondering what you personally think, like, with the anti-hijab
movement and the hundreds of thousands of like activists and bloggers that there are in Iran, how do you think that's going to progress in the next few years, and whether it is going to progress?
Question
outside.
Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, your solution to the exportation of Islamism appears to me, I mean, maybe I misunderstood, but like exporting the Western secularism to the so-called Muslim world. But when I see, for example, in my own country of Italy, that we have blasphemy laws, that, like, for example, in the recent migrant crisis, Slovakia says, yes, we will accept migrants only if they're Christians. Like, when we're just pretending to have real secularism in Europe, for example, and so, like, when we pretend to have something, it doesn't mean that we actually have one, as in many so-called Islamic states, they have democracy formally, but not really. So it's like, what's
it's
your...
It's Islamic democracy.
Yeah. What are your thoughts on that?
Okay. Okay. yes?
You've probably been asked this quite a bit before. I just noticed that you used the word Islamism a lot. So I just want to ask, like, do you not think it's maybe a bit unfair to Muslims and just,
okay,
you know, wrong to kind of associate these horrible acts, like, you know, acid attacks or vigilante executions, things like that, to associate them kind of with Islam just through using such a similar word?
Okay. What word do you use when you talk about...
I don't know, but you could use a different word, like, I mean, you could say terrorism,
it was, okay, you know, something. Okay, that's a good question. Okay, on the issue of Iran, I mean, I think Iran is, and I'm not saying that just because I'm not a nationalist, and I think home is where you live and where you can finally have some semblance of freedom, but I do think that Iran is a real center of free thought and secularism, atheism in that region. And it has been, you know, a constant back and forth, hasn't it? There's been lots of protests and times when we thought, it's over, the regime is going, we're all going back home, and then of course it hasn't happened. And I think that, you know, the Islamic regime has suppressed many movements that could possibly have changed things for the better. But what's very clear in Iran is that while you can't say when it's going to happen, I do think it is a question not of if, but when. Because of the fact that there is this regime that is, you know, in a sense at a dead end and isn't able to handle the immense protests that it's being challenged with. So you often hear, you know, I don't know, just to give you some examples where you have this, you know, the Iranian parliament is full of mullahs, of course. And so you had one MP coming late to work, and it was televised. And they asked him, well, why are you so late? And he said, because I was wearing my religious clothes, and I couldn't get a taxi. Not all the taxis refused to pick me up because I just hate clerics so much. So he had to go home, change into normal clothes, and then he was able to get a cab ride to the office. You know, so there is a sort of a hatred of Islamists, and especially because, you know, people can't even do very normal things because it is like an Inquisition. You know, this is what you call totalitarianism, where you do have control on, you're having a party, you're worried that they're going to come. If your hijab is back, nonetheless, despite that, you've got all these people unveiling when it's against the law and posting pictures on social media. So it shows that one, this movement has moved so forward that it's not afraid as well, and that it is challenging them. And you do always hear from Iranian regime officials who say, oh, you know, we haven't been able to Islamicize the universities enough, or we haven't been able to, get women to do as we say. And a lot of these are born and raised in an Islamic regime. That's all they've ever known. So I think it is a very hopeful thing. Maybe one day we'll say that, you know, every time someone goes, a Westerner goes and speaks at a university, they'll say, you know, that's an Eastern concept, secularism. You don't deserve it here. Because I do think it's going to be a center of great things. But, I mean, having said that, things, you know, this is a question of struggle. Things are not guaranteed, are they? These are things you fight for, and possibly you can win if you fight for them. One of the problems is that the solidarity that's needed in order for people to be able to push that regime over hardly exists, because it is racism to defend people people who are opposing an Islamic regime. It is Islamophobic, it is this, that, and the other. And so that solidarity that we saw, for example, against racial apartheid in South Africa, we need to see that against sexual apartheid in Iran and elsewhere. And I think once we have that, it will make it much easier for people there to fight. On the question of Western secularism, I mean, I think the point I was trying to make is that I don't think secularism is a Western concept. And I think it's, you know, if you live in a theocracy, it's something that I think becomes very much part of your understanding. You may not call it secularism, you may not know what the term is, you may not know the history, you might even be, you know, living in a small village in Iran, but you understand the concept that you want the separation of religion from the state. You have, for example, that protest in Afghanistan I showed you where they say, cut the hand of religion from the society. These are people who might be religious, but they understand that religion should be a private matter and that it's safer for women, it's safer for minorities, it's safer for gay people, it's safer for anyone who transgresses their rules, Muslim or not. It's safer if they have religion out of the public space. So I would say that it's not a Western concept, it's a universal one. You know, and it always amazes me that the Iranian regime will want to access nuclear technology. Isn't that a Western technology? But they never call it Western. They want the nuclear bomb. But when it comes to secularism and rights, and particularly women's equality, it becomes Western. You know, and the fact of the matter is that any right has never been handed over by governments. It's been taken very often by force, by people's movements. And in that sense, they belong to all of humanity. You know, if, I don't know, suffragists win the vote in one country, you know, women elsewhere will be inspired. And then if people tell them, well, this is a British thing, you can't have it, you know, it's people say that who don't want you to have equality and don't want you to have secularism. But having said that, that doesn't mean that we live in, you know, having said that, one, secularism is not the perfect end-all, it's just a minimum precondition. But second of all, that doesn't, of course, necessarily mean that Western societies are secular. In no way are they. You're looking at Britain, where you've got bishops in the House of Lords, the Queen is the head of the Church of England. We have to pay for these people, parasites, honestly, in my opinion. Sorry, don't get upset. Okay, some will get happy. And, you know, you've got so much accommodation of religion. Religion has such a privileged position in Britain. So I think, you know, when people shout, we want a secular Europe, I say, well, first of all, we need to work towards a really secular Europe. And it's not enough to say you want a secular Europe. We want a secular world. If we agree that secularism is good, it is a good thing, we should be confident to say it, confident to fight for it, and find our secularist allies amongst Muslims and many others who are doing it day in and day out on the front lines. And we miss that if we think, oh, this is a Western thing, we can't intervene. Not, of course, I'm not talking about military intervention, I'm talking people-to-people solidarity and intervention. On the use of the term Islamist, I mean, if you don't like it, you should tell them, because that's what they call themselves as well. Do you know what I mean? Islamists will call themselves Islamists. And also, I think terrorism is insufficient, because terrorism is the only, that's really what the very many Western governments don't like. You know, they're fine with bombs in marketplaces in Baghdad, or in the Shia mosque, or in the Sunni this, here and there. They're quite fine with that. What they don't like is the terrorism that comes into Europe.
Well, I don't think they don't call themselves Islamists. Like, for example, ISIS might call themselves Daesh or something, but
like, Daesh is just an acronym for ISIS.
As in, they might say that they're Muslims. But they aren't really.
No, because they
are not. But it's not even, like, it's not them we listen to, it's the speakers and, like, the media and everything. That's where, like, 90% of the term, like, the use of the term will come from. Mm-hmm. And that's where the association will come. So it's actually, like, the media's.
I think, no, I don't think it's a media thing. I think for us, like, in Iran, for example, it's very clear for us, Islam, you know, it's the Islamists. That's what we call them. In many countries where you're working with people who are fighting the Islamists, I think in fact it does make it very clear that it's not about a belief. it's Islam is the belief, Islamism is a far-right political movement. It's like the Christian right. This is a term that I think a lot of you use, the Christian right. The Hindu right, Modi is here, he is definitely not welcome. The Hindu right, the Buddhist right in Myanmar and Sri Lanka that are massacring Muslims as we speak. These are right-wing movements very often, and this is what it's called. And I think, in fact, if you see it within that framework of, you know, religious right-wing movements that are political, that use religion as a banner, but for political gains, that they're more political movements than religious ones, I think, and to put it in that context, I think it's actually a very good thing to do because it separates it from criticism of religion, though I think criticism of religion is necessary, but most importantly, it separates it from people, yeah. Muslims. And also I think one of the problems is that my problem is not terrorism alone. Yeah, I think for me, Sharia law, which says that a woman's testimony is worth half of a man's, where stoning for adultery, if all the conditions are met, is fine. You know, where gender segregation is fine, where you can amputate limbs and this and that. I think that is a form of terrorism against the population at large. It's not called terrorism, but it is also a form, and I think that's why it's important to deal with a movement that wants the Khalifah, that wants Sharia law, and that targets women. Women are its first targets. There's a wonderful quote by Khalid Hosseini, you know, the Afghan writer. I can't remember his, you know, he's done the kite runner, the other one. There's that quote in his book, I don't know, that really made me think this is exactly what they are, where he says their fingers are like the compass, always pointing north. And it always, always finds a woman. It always points to women, no matter what. And I think these are characteristics of Islamism, and they can be very easily sought out. And I think it's important, actually, to label a movement in order to be able to fight
it. I was thinking, for example, like, do you know when there's, like, the Catholic scandal? Do you know when there's, like, the Roman Catholic scandal?
Yeah.
Like, where priests would be, obviously, abusing children,
yeah.
All that. Like, that, for example, that wasn't called Catholicism or, you know, anything similar to Catholic Church. And if it was, I'm pretty sure it would be shut down. People would start accusing that the use of that term. They would heavily defend, like, the Catholic Church.
I mean, I will say this, and I don't want to go back and forth on this, but maybe I'll let other people ask some more questions.